Isn't it good? Isn't it good to be in church? Anyone blessed this morning already? Brilliant to stand in the presence of Jesus and go, I am who you say I am. And I'm going to speak on that this morning because last week I started this series called Grace Stories. And I'm asking the question, what, see in your life, right? So get your Bibles ready because we're going to flick through, going to base this on 1 John and then some stuff from the book of Romans. But last Sunday night I was talking about grace. We did church on Sunday night last week because of the marathon. Did I mention that we ran in the marathon? No. No, did I mention that? Am I looking slimmer? No. And we ran the marathon last week, and we did church on Sunday night, which I actually really enjoyed. It was quite a nice vibe around it, wasn't it? Wasn't it good? So we might do that again at some point. But I was talking about what happens whenever grace meets your mess. What happens whenever the grace of Jesus meets your mess? And what does it mean? Why would you care? And why does it matter? Because there's something about, I believe that the journey for us all is an increasing revelation of Jesus and his love, increasing revelation of Jesus and his work. Because to the day you die, you will be discovering the length, the breadth, the depth, and the height of God's love for you. It will never be redundant or run out. And actually, the way to experiencing more of the goodness of God is not working harder for God, we know this, but it's actually to receive more of Jesus and his work. And last week I was saying, but the issue is that where Jesus starts, I talked about the woman who's caught in adultery and saying that even though she is banged to rights, folks, she is guilty as charged. There is no way about it. The path to freedom with Jesus starts with, you know, I do not condemn you, but I do not condone what you do. But make no bones about it. Most of us start with that. He doesn't condone. And then I don't condone your sin. But with the woman caught in adultery, what he does is he says, I am not going to punish you and condemn you for your sin. Because Jesus was going to demonstrate the path to freedom. But he says, now don't stay in it. But he understands that, you know, for all of us, the more we try with the things that enslave us and are hard, the stronger we make them. That's actually in the Bible. So if you have stuff going on in your world today and you have tried your level best to break free and to get through, by your own effort, what you do is you actually strengthen sin. Because it says that the strength of sin, the strength of actually all those acts of rebellion towards God is law, is that mentality which goes, I will do it and therefore God will bless me. By the work of my hand, I will be acceptable to God. And actually the word says, the more you try that, the strength of the very thing that holds you in bondage is your effort to try to break it. Does that make sense? So what Jesus does with the woman in adultery is he says, actually, right now, I don't condemn you. Even though she is completely guilty. He understands, and I talked, it was a great talk, go and watch it online. It's a really good talk about going, you know, whenever you come to the Lord, he's going to show you freedom, but it might not look like what you think it is, but he always starts with, I don't condemn. The law condemns, and the law is perfect and right. The law is holy. We're not anti-law people. Antinomianism is called, okay? That is not what grace is all about, but it's about going, there is no way in this great green earth that God has created that we were ever going to keep it. We are stuffed, all right? We are absolutely stuffed in every way. No way to go. You try to earn your way into this much of God's favor and you will push yourself further and deeper into your mess. So the only way then is Jesus, thank you. You are incredible. And when people get blasé about the love of Jesus, I go, have you really understood it? Because actually, when you understand that the tiniest amount of effort will reap so much more back into your life in terms of negativity and sin, but one little tiny ounce of God's grace will set you free forever. All right? And so I want to talk about that today. I love this in Romans 3:24. Let's just get cracking. It says that, yeah, God with undeserved kindness. Yeah, we don't deserve the kindness of God, but do you know what he says? You're dead acceptable. That's what righteous means. He says, you know, when in Jesus, when you're in Christ, my kindness, completely undeserved, because we all know the ready reckoner of our lives. We go, do you know what? We're actually not all that we pretend to be. We're not our Facebook or our Instagram posts. You know what I mean? We're not that. There's a whole lot of other stuff that goes on and we're all pretty complex and some of it good and some of it not so good. And he says in the middle of it all, but you know what? It's undeserved kindness. I'm saying, I'm declaring, I'm shouting that you are acceptable to me because of Jesus. This is what he says in the beginning of the book of Romans. So if you want to have your life, and in this time where we're, expecting and believing God to do five times more in our lives, it's if you want to experience that presence and power of God and to see those promises manifested in you, then what you have to do is you have to really guard what goes on in here. And I want to speak just about one person whose mess met Jesus, whose mess met grace and what he did. Where did he start again with them? Because in Proverbs 23:7, it says, as you think in your most innermost place, okay, that's how you live. As a man thinks in his heart, Labab in Hebrew, that means the very innermost part of you. So not what you say, not what you want to portray, but what really goes on in you is how you live. Now, I want to show you today about how Jesus encountered someone who's actually Peter. And whenever you have feelings of guilt and shame and condemnation, right, and that's going on in your life, and then you're not seeing breakthrough, there is a core belief in you, okay, that is limiting what God can do. We may have altered our position with God, positionally righteous and positionally okay with God. But what about actually moving into that space where we know and we live and we know how he feels about us? We know how he wants to bless us. And we can live with expectation and faith that because we are who he says we are, that we can walk in the goodness of that every day. Because to whatever extent I believe that's demonstrated in most of our lives, shows where some of us need to have a reprogramming. So this morning is a wee bit about reprogramming and some of the law mentality. And can I say this, that in one of my favorite verses that really struck me when I started to really understand it was in Romans 2:4, it says, do not despise the riches of his goodness, tolerance, or do you despise the riches of his goodness for forbearance and suffering? Not knowing that it's God's goodness this morning that's gonna lead you to change. It is only God's goodness that will lead you to change. And whenever you first came to Jesus, you know, we have that moment where you remember where it was totally about him, completely and utterly. You have that moment where you go, flip, if this is true, there's nothing I can do. You know, I absolutely, you love me and it's independent of my behavior. And so I just surrender. Well, see, in that moment, that's exactly the way that the Lord wants to keep you walking. Kept carried and held in exactly the same way. His love, his favor, his commitment, his decision, his promise, received in that moment, in the moments of every day. And so we've got to guard our heart around that. It's interesting for me that some people do preach that grace is the power to change. Grace is not the power to change. Grace is a gift from God which produces change. And that's really important that we get that one nailed this morning. Because I know, and it's actually some people who I kind of respect, will preach the message of grace is the empowerment of God. Grace is the gift of God. And in receiving the gift, we change. I'm gonna set that up for later on. And it's really important that we understand that, because it's not about I receive grace and it's like this is my way of changing. It's like I receive Jesus and the fruit of that in my life is. And you can't receive like grace as a kind of abstract concept outside of who Jesus is, because he is grace personified. All right, so in receiving Jesus, we're gonna be changed. I'm setting this up. All right, so if I can encourage you this week, it says here that in Proverbs 4:23, above everything else, really think about this week. I'm gonna go pretty slow on this one. For everything you do, everything you're gonna set your hand to this week, everything that comes from your thinking, every way that you interact in a relationship, flows from what is inside you. So the Hebrew word here, natsar, means consider, examine, protect, watch over what is on the inside of you. Because whilst religion will tell you to watch what you're doing and watch your behavior, I've said this many times before, obedience is not the root of the Christian life. And if you're trying to obey your way to blessing, you're gonna end up in a cycle of defeat and a cycle where you strengthen sin. Obedience is not the root of the Christian life. It is the fruit of encountering Jesus. That's what we saw with the woman caught in adultery. When she encountered Jesus, he said, I don't condemn you. You're forgiven now. Go and sin no more. So the no sinning comes after the gift of no condemnation. And we have to get that order absolutely right. And this is why some of us don't break through. But you know what? You have to really consider that and let that sit in your heart and go, what is really going on with me? Not what I'm saying or pretending, but what is actually going on. Because in this story today, it's interesting that
it's like almost from the very beginning, Jesus goes, let me show you how I'm going to deal with you. And then what we do is we do something different, and that's why there's a disconnect. Now, let me just help you. If you're on a journey of grace and going, well, does it not really matter then what we do? Is that what you're saying? And absolutely not. That's not what I'm saying. What about my actions and what I do? Okay, are they completely irrelevant? Well, actually, Paul in the book of Romans talks about Abraham. You know, Abraham is the father of faith, so we're the children of Abraham, because God said he was righteous and acceptable, not because of what he did. Hundreds of years before the law, Abraham believed, and it was a credit to him as righteousness. Okay, hundreds of years before law was given. So he believed and placed faith in what God had said to him and made known to him. Okay, I'm going to talk about this later, but something really interesting, Romans 4 verse 10, there's this verse, he said, Abraham was circumcised. So what some people do is you say, well, it's okay to believe a little bit, all right? But he also followed the law. But why would he have been circumcised otherwise as a sign of covenant? And actually what's really interesting for me is he received circumcision, it says here in Romans 4:10, as a sign, a seal of what? Of the righteousness that he had by faith while he was still uncircumcised. All right. So what I'm trying to say to you is this. If you want to live for God, if you want to see this fruit in your life, okay, the outward signs always follow what happens on the inside of you. That's the bottom line. So Abraham, you know, was circumcised after he had received faith when he was still uncircumcised. There's a lot of circumcision going on in this talk. For that, I can only apologize. We try to keep it family friendly, but you know what? Sometimes you just... but you know what I mean? I'm trying to say to you folks this morning that the fruit of God's goodness and living in the goodness of it is as a result of you receiving faith, the result of you guarding your heart in terms of what you receive and not allowing anything to come into the way of that. Because if not, what will happen is when your mess, okay, when your mess meets law, all it does is it compounds your mess. It makes you feel worse. It strengthens sin in your life. But when your mess meets God's grace and favor, there's always freedom. Always no condemnation. Always life. Amen? So that's what we're going to look at now. So I want to say that if you are struggling with the outside stuff, with behaviors and patterns and thinking and all the rest of that, your behavior will change, but it's going to change from a changed heart. It's not going to be changed because you're going to make a big effort to change. And if I say it again, I'll say it 100 times over this next number of weeks in this series. Obedience to God is the fruit of a changed heart and not the root of receiving anything. Really, really important that we guard our heart in that. Because I say things like, and you go, yes, amen, brother, that's fantastic. Then what happens is in your moments of failure this week, our hearts and our heads go back to, oh no, see, I did that, and therefore, you know, isn't that right? In the moment. And so it's really important that we guard and protect whenever the Lord brings a word like this morning to go, receive this word deep into your heart. Because grace is not just, okay, a positional change. This is gonna be a real simple talk this morning, and it will produce something that in you, a power that will change you completely, because it's grace ministers and speaks right into your very identity in a way that brings about healing and transformation and leads to a changed life, okay? It starts with the difference between how we see ourselves and the way that Jesus sees us. And there's this encounter that I absolutely love, okay, with, and it's the beginning of the whole church, and it's before anything else ever happens with this guy. And sometimes we overlook this, but there's some wee gems hidden in the middle of it where Jesus looks, and the same way that he looks at Peter is the same way that he's looking at you today. And then the story, we're going to see the difference in two perspectives. And I think that in our Christian walk and in your world this week, your battle is not going to be any other thing other than, can I stay in the same perspective as Jesus right now? Can I align with what he says I am about me? Because when I'm aligned with him, then the fruit flows. And when I'm connected with him, then the fruit flows. It's like I told the story before of Penny and I, when we were walking down the street one day, and there's these two guys walking towards us, right? And I love my wife dearly and sincerely, but there was a white guy and a black guy walking towards us, okay? And the black guy was the absolute spit of Chris Akabusi. Remember the sprinter? I swear, I thought, that's Chris Akabusi, right? The other guy, you know, was as pale and as white, and obviously friends walking along. And I said to Penny, here, look, no way, there's Chris Akabusi. And she was walking along and she went, which one? And I went, you know, like sometimes you're just stunned and you go, what do you mean, which one? The black dude. He's a black sprinter. He's an unbelievable athlete. And she's going, why? Now that I look at him, I think you're right. I was like, are you for real? Do you know what I mean? I was like, seriously? Which one? It's like, oh, help me, Jesus. But I remember laughing at it. You know, life's full of these things. Do you know the most of the tension that we feel in our lives is about different perspectives? Let me tell you a story that happened to me yesterday. Just to go, it's all about your view. Your view is key. I went yesterday to wash my car, right? And I thought, I'm going to wash it myself because I should do that for some reason. And I went and I bought, a jet wash. Now, this is funny. There's sometimes a bit like that where you're so stunned by stupidity, it actually, you know, you go, I actually don't know how to deal with this. So I bought myself a ticket and it was at £1 for 3 minutes. So I bought three. Now, let's do the math, right? Go with me on this because perspective is king. £3 equals how many minutes? 9, okay? It's like an AQE class. Just bear with me. If you didn't get 9, okay, go slower. You can use your calculators for this exercise, all right? So there's me out giving it all that on the jet wash. And after about 5 minutes, the thing stopped. I was like, ooh, I've been diddled. All right. So every pound being a prisoner, I decided, right, I'm going to walk back in. And I had my ticket. And I didn't have my ticket. I had my ticket in my pocket. And I said, here, that was that 9 minutes? That was really fast. And the girl behind the counter said, you see, that's what happens when you're washing your car. It goes so fast, you'd hardly even know it. I went, all right. I said, well, can I have another few minutes? Another six, because half the car was still soapy. So I gave her another couple of pounds. And I walked back out. But you know what? I just felt the witness of the Spirit going, check your ticket, Amber. Check your ticket. That's a lie. It was pure flesh, me going, geez, I've just had my leg lifted. This is no good. So I had a hook around, right? And I pulled out my ticket. And so I bought the first ticket at 11:06. And then I bought the second ticket at 11:14. Are you with me? So I was like, that's it. I'm going to get that pound back, all right? So I walked back into the shop. Now, this is what happened, right? I haven't even told Penny this. This is what happened. The wee girl who served me ran quicker than Linford Christie out the back, all right? So she did a bolter out the back, and I left this woman starry-eyed, seeing me walking up covered in soap suds, right? And right? It's moments like that where you go, this is why I don't wash my own car, right? That'd been a nightmare, giving it all that. I was covered in soap suds, standing there, and I went, I think you made a mistake with my ticket. She went, I don't think we did. So inside, I'm going, oh, Jesus, she might watch some of this online. So I said, okay, well, help me out here. So I put the two tickets side by side and said, can you see the time on that? 11:06. How many minutes did I pay for? 9, right? So what if you add 9 minutes on the 11:06, bearing in mind it took me 2 minutes to get my car, drive it in, get out, okay? And what time would that make it? You thought I'd ask her to split the atom. Do you know what I mean? I was going, like, seriously, what time does that make it? She was like, at this point, there's a queue building. I was like, you know what? I'm digging in. And I said, let me help you. 11:15. She went, that's right. And I said, so if I pay for 9 minutes and it ran out and I've come in and I've bought another ticket and this one says 11:14. Do you kind of see what's going on? And she went, look me in the eye. Queue now out the door at Sainsbury's, right? She went, I don't think you're right. At this point, I went, oh, Jesus, fix your eyes upon Jesus. What's going on? I've gone, tell me why that is. She went, well, the times could just be wrong. And I went, well, there's some kind of matrix thing, time warp going on between here and your jet wash out the back. Like, seriously, love, come on, help me out. It can't be 9 minutes. I mean, there's not an international timeline between here and your jet wash. You know, you don't go back an hour if you walk towards B&Q. I'm like, seriously? You diddled me out of my pound. And she went, well, I don't think you're right. I actually don't think you're right because, hold on, I better go and check. I was like, oh, Jesus, help me out. So she actually then went out the back to get the manager, who didn't have the guts to come out. And then behind me, this woman went, oh no, I'm here for a jet wash. And I went, you know what? Let me tell you. You are in trouble. I said, make sure you have 20 quid in your wallet, because you'll not get your car washed. And I'm thinking, oh, Andrew, calm it down. The boy behind the woman who's coming for the jet wash was just standing there going, laughing his leg off. And then, so anyway, long story short, the manager who wouldn't come out to face me came out and said, or said the other ground, now this is where I'm thinking, oh, said, on this one occasion, as a goodwill gesture, we are willing to refund you your pound. Now, if I was a big enough man, I'd have just gone, thanks very much, and walked out. But I took two steps like this and I went, hold on a wee minute. You're not refunding me anything. I'd already paid for it. No, well, we're giving you a ticket, which will give you an extra 3 minutes for free, and there's your pound back. I was like, no, I paid for it. Actually, you're a pound up. And she was like, well, I don't see it that way. And I was like, at this point, I thought, oh, I need to go. So anyway, it's a long story of going, see, when people don't see things the same way as you, it will drive you to distraction, won't it? All right? Like, Chris Akabusi, which one? Like, I mean, you're honestly, like, saying, how can we look at something, right, which seems blindingly obvious and see it differently? Right? But the thing is, for that girl yesterday, and I'm only keeping you going, I mean, you know, I'll send her a tract or something and, you know, one of my CDs. How's that? I'll tighten her. But the thing is, it's like, I don't think she was being difficult. I think just genuinely she struggled to go, but I don't see it. I'm looking at the same thing and I'm seeing something completely different. And she was digging in because that was her view, all right? And me saying what seemed really obvious on the other side made no difference to her. Okay. In fact, what it did was she felt threatened, so she dug in even more, and then I dug in, and then there was 19 people wanting to pay for their petrol, you know, and I could feel her eyes in the back of my head. So here's the truth of it is I will never set foot in Sainsbury's Hollywood Exchange ever again. They probably have my poster up there, all right? If you see this man, all right? Oh, thank goodness. It's flipping hilarious. But, you know, yes, I'm going to pay somebody to do it. I'll pay the kids. I don't know what went on in my head, but just prove you never wash your own car. It's people to do that sort of stuff. So, but do you know what's interesting for me? I did come away slightly frustrated, but also going, there is something really, really strong in people, which goes, when I see it a certain way, even when it's somebody brings other evidence to us and says, but actually this, is, look at it, but I still don't see it. You know, that's what we do with Jesus every day. He comes to us with a different view and a different grid, all right? When we encounter Jesus for the first time, we begin to understand that his grid and his view is nothing like ours. It's not even like it's close and the two things mesh. When he looks at you, it is completely different to anything that you're looking at this morning. Thank God. It's completely different. And it's a different scale, a different lens at which he looks and he deals with us with. And the biggest, and as human beings, I think our biggest struggle is that we can only see and only estimate and only view what we see right in front of us and what we deal with. And we need a revelation of the way that Jesus sees us today. The way that Jesus sees you today is not even close sometimes to the way that you view yourself. Whatever you might say, whatever way you might pretend, what really goes on in the innermost part about what we truly believe who we are and what we do and how it impacts on who we are, we need to let the Lord right into that place. Because it's from that place that you will live. It's from that place that you won't have to work hard, but the blessings and the favor and the fullness of God will fall on you, will be all around you, that everything you set your hand to will be prospered and blessed and successful. Why? Because you're working harder? No, because him in you bringing about the fruit. And so it kind of forms our foundation, the backdrop actually to how we treat each other, how we deal with each other, and how we feel about ourselves. Isn't it interesting? I've mentioned this a couple of times, but some of you might not have heard about it. Do you know what the world does? It's a thing called labeling theory. Psychologists and sociologists in the 60s came up with this stuff, and it was a way really of majorities primarily looking at how minorities would act, okay? But what these guys start to look at it is how incredible, right? when we are given labels, particularly from an early age, how much that forms us and shapes us. Now, these are not believers, but they understand something about what is said and what we receive and how it forms and shapes how we live. You see, people who don't know Jesus, no revelation of God and his word, in the secular world, in the world of psychology and understanding human behavior and everything else, and they're saying the same thing, but the only problem is they have no way out. They have no way of changing the label other than going, that's just who, you're not that, you know. You're better than that. You know, you are a strong and powerful woman. All those tapes that you play. I don't play those tapes, but if you're you're a strong and powerful woman, you know, playing them over and over. It's a whole branch of psychology, you know, and it's not just like you're stupid. It could be lazy, selfish, not intelligent, ugly. I'm going to say it, gay, mentally ill, underachiever. And there's this whole branch of psychology that's grown around us. And that essentially what the theory is concerned with, so the world understands this, that self-identity and behavior of people is highly determined and highly influenced by the terms that are used to describe or classify them. You know something? When you give yourself a name or somebody else does, you tend to live to it. Your behavior tends to go that way because that's who I am. And I've got to tell you this morning that for freedom's sake, I kind of felt like this is what happened, because that can feel like a mess, but what happens when that mess encounters Jesus? Let me go very quickly, because God gives us a whole new set of labels. Grace gives us a new name. He looks at us and he sees something so completely different. And when you encounter him in this way, you will be radically transformed. In Romans 4:17, it says, in the presence of him who he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. Now, you might not see all that God has done for you, but he just doesn't look at where you are today. He looks at what he has called you to be. Let me just quickly show you this encounter, because I said I wouldn't talk for long this morning. Let's read it. In John chapter 1, this is right at the very beginning of Jesus calling his disciples. And I love this version in John 1, because there are words that are unpacked there. Again, the next day, John stood with two of his disciples, and looking at Jesus, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him speak and they followed Jesus. Then Jesus turned and seeing them following, said to them, what do you seek? And he said to them, Rabbi, which is translated as teacher, where are you staying? He said to them, come and see. They came and saw where he was staying and remained with him that day. Now it was about the 10th hour. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, we have found the Messiah, which is translated the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Now, when Jesus looked at him, he said, you are Simon, the son of Jonah, and you shall be called Kephas. This is in John chapter 1. Now, what the heck does that mean for you this week? And why is it an important principle about how Jesus wants to change your grid? Because the Apostle Peter is one of the most well-known individuals in the Bible. In fact, do you know in the New Testament, Peter's mentioned, he's mentioned more than anybody else apart from Jesus himself. So there's a lot going on with this guy. And I think lots of people love him because of his personality. You know, if you're a modern man, you kind of get Peter because he's not hard to relate to. It's because his personality is almost timeless. I think it's not bound by culture. You're not having to figure through culture and all that sort of stuff and the age in which he lived. He's all out there and he's all man. He was a working man. He was a hard man. He was a physical man. He was a fisherman. He was dead passionate. Right, you see that, but often got him into trouble, cutting off ears and all sorts of stuff. He's also quick to speak his mind. He speaks very quickly, sometimes without thinking it through. He didn't really hold back or take the time to think. Anyone going, oh, it could be me, bits of it anyway. Well, look at you also flipping holy in here this morning. What's interesting then is Peter was a guy who promised Jesus he would follow them right to the end of time. Wherever he went, I'm going to be there. But he was the man who would turn his back on him and deny him three times. Peter was all of those things and he was so much more. This is not a talk particularly about that, but he expresses qualities which I believe any of us in any age can absolutely identify with. Now, let me just tell you this. Simon Peter, he was called Simon, his brother is Andrew. Andrew means strong, manly, handsome, sexy, intelligent. All the doubters, Lord, just convict them in Jesus' name. Look at the unbelief in this room. Okay, Simon, though, even in Penny's eyes, that's really worrying. Simon, though, means hearer. Okay? Now, Jesus comes along to him. This is really important. It's a wee bit technical, but really listen. Jesus comes along, and so here's a guy called Simon who hears. And Jesus says to him, now you're going to be called Kephas. Now, Kephas is an Aramaic word, and it means rock. Now, Simon continued, listen to me, to be called by his birth name until the point, remember where it was the confession where, you know, who do you say I am? And he says that, Jesus, you're Lord. And then Jesus said to him, right now, you're going to be called Peter. So he's called Simon. So this is what happens at the very beginning. Jesus sees him, the hearer, and he says, you are Kephas, which means rock. Now, the writers keep using the word Simon, okay, until the point where he confesses Jesus. And then what they do is they start to call him Peter. Now, why did they do that? It's an interesting thing to note. Whenever the New Testament writers wrote his name, they didn't use the word Kepha, but they actually translated it. So that's how we get Peter, right? So they, instead of writing down Kepha, they went, what does that mean? Oh, Jesus said rock, right? It means rock, right? So names are names. The writers don't change any other names, but apart from Peter's here. The point is that what they were doing is, in that moment, what they were doing was they were writing down who Jesus said he was and not just using the name. Do you get that? And so the point is they were writing down and calling him by his identity and not the name. And the name that they wrote down, so they go from Kephas, it's Aramaic. They go, what does that mean? That means Petros. And then Petros, oh, Peter, all right? So they actually called him Petros, and therefore we get the name Peter from that. Is everybody following me here? Okay. So whenever Jesus changed his name from the hearer to the rock, right, it was something that was going on that was so much deeper than simply a name change. So here we are thousands of years before labeling theory and people trying to understand it. And Jesus goes in a moment before this guy. And here's the thing, God, Jesus is already outside of time. He's in the world, okay? But we already know that he has a view, Jesus, of, you know, because he's from heaven, God himself made flesh, right? So his view is totally different. His grid is totally different. So he's looking at this guy at the very beginning, a working, passionate, hard fisherman. He's looking at him and he's going, he probably knew all the mess that Peter was going to create. He didn't look at him and go through an interview process and go, actually, tell me about your self-control and your, you know, your education. Remember when Jesus said, follow me, to these guys who were working? They were working because the religious people had already rejected them. Do you know that? If you were a fisherman at this stage, it was because you weren't smart enough to be religious. So all the smart kids were sitting under rabbis learning the Torah and doing all that. Peter and his clan had been rejected by the religious people. And then a rabbi comes along and the rabbi says, follow me. And the actual word follow means me, the whole sense of it, when a rabbi called you, he was saying, you can be like me. Now, does anyone ever feel underqualified? Like not as smart as the clever people on the other end of it? And then Jesus comes along and says, not just follow me. He doesn't say to you, follow me today. When he speaks into your world, he says, you can be like me. When I step into your world, remember, Jesus is on the beach walking along. He's not calling them to some temple to come and sit at his feet. He's saying, I'm going to go into your world. I'm going to go where you're working hard. I'm going to go where it's all happening for you, in a place where you are trying to make it all happen. And I'm going to say, you can be like me. So come along. That's not the point of the talk. The point is then he goes, you're Kephas. All right? And here's where we have two different perspectives. Because when we look at Peter, all right, what he's saying is later on, Jesus goes on to say in Matthew 16, verse 18, right? You're going to see how Jesus in the moment, at the very beginning, before all the action, listen to me, this week when you go out there, before all the action, before all the words, the thoughts, the deeds, before any of that happens, when Jesus looks at you, he says, this is who you are. You are righteous and holy and blameless and loved. You are safe. You are secure. Now from that place, let's go.
Because with Peter, that's what he's doing. He knows that Peter's going to mess it up. He knows that Peter's a passionate guy. He knows that he's a hardworking fisherman who would knock your melt in, as we would say in Belfast. He's all in. There's no half measures. He is full in. And Jesus looks at him and goes, but you know what? With me, Peter, I'm going to build my church on you. So forget what everyone else is saying. When I look at you, the first thing I see is you are a rock. What does he say to you this morning? It's so important, church. It is so important that before anything else, we allow all our stuff to encounter the God who gives us a new name. And not just a name which is a set of letters to identify ourselves, but one that goes right to the root of who we are and calls us out as sons and daughters of Jesus himself. And from that place, we walk to freedom. From that place, we walk into everything that God has for us. It's interesting, Matthew 16, verse 18, he then says, I also say that you're Peter. This is the bit, the confession of Christ. So right at the very beginning, I love this. See, in those moments, every time this week where you have that condemnation and stuff that attacks your heart and you're trying to guard your innermost place, just you remember that every time the Lord looks at you, he calls out not what you have done, but when he looks at you, who he sees that you are. And that's the only thing he calls out. That's outrageous grace. Because there's something in us that goes, but what about I've done this? What about I've done that? What about what I will do? And he says, look at that cross, past, present, and future. Every single one of your sins is dealt with. No big surprise to me. I am not using the grid of the law because I kept it perfect and completely on your behalf. I am using the gift of my outrageous grace for you. It is completely undeserved. His kindness is never earned. It is outrageously abundant towards you today. Isn't that incredible? And he says from this place, he says now, Matthew 16, this is further on, this is the confession. He goes, now you're Peter, okay? And on this rock, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So he's reminding him, he uses two words. You are Peter, you are Petros, Kephas, remember translated from the little rock? So you're the little rock, Peter, okay? And on this, Petros is the little rock. And on this rock, Petra, different words used, means a massive cliff, actually. I'm going to build my church. I'm going to build my church. Here's what Jesus is trying to say, okay? You're kind of cut from the same rock. I am the rock, and you are taken from me. And we would say, like, he's a chip of the old block. You're a chip off the old block, made from the same stuff. He says, now, I'm the one that the church is built on. It won't be built on. And people say, well, Peter's the rock and the church was built on him. Well, he started the church. But actually, when you look at what Jesus said, he said, I'm the rock and you are cut from me. All right? So what that means is we are the same stuff, made from the same stuff. Okay? There's not a difference. You might be a little bit of it right now, and I'm the big bit of it, but we're cut from the same. Isn't that incredible? I really want to encourage you today. That's what the Lord sees in you. He didn't say, Peter, you are a flipping balloon, mate. Honest to goodness, can we ever have a word? Because you're doing my bad, man. Honestly, what is the whole cut in the ear thing of? Like, seriously, and then, like, you've dissed me. You keep walking away from me. You know, if that was me, I'd probably go, and I know you're sharing that, mate, but, you know, let's just look at your history. Let's just say it's not looking good for you. You know, I can't trust a word that you say. Yeah, when I read the Bible, I kind of read it that way to go, how would I behave if I was Jesus? It probably would be completely different. But he has this obstinate refusal to deal with us. Can I just say that? I think the Lord has an obstinate refusal to deal with you in any other grid other than the lens of Jesus and what he did. There's no light that's in the side. It's just Jesus. Only Jesus, and forever will be Jesus. And the more that captures us, the more we will live free. So this week, I want to encourage you that was Peter's new label. Peter's label from the very beginning was rock. Your label, you've got way more than Peter, because Peter didn't live in the fullness of Christ because he was at that point. We live in the fullness of the covenant of God's grace and love. So every label that is Jesus's is now yours.
and you're cut from the same. So as he is, so are we in this world. So if you're sick this morning, can I just say, I'm going to just minister some stuff to you right now before we finish. You know, you kind of go, is Petra, the big rock, sick this morning? No? So now am I. I receive my healing in Jesus' name. Am I depressed? The big rock's not depressed. I'm cut from the same. So therefore, I receive that I'm not depressed. Amen.